refreshments that were provided, and for those of you that could not be there to help, I know that you were praying for us. I want to encourage you to be here next Sabbath. Rebecca will be sharing her personal testimony titled The Private Struggles of a New Advent. You will be blessed by being here. Yeah. How many of you had rather be here than the guest hospital in Pensacola?
Amen.
And I think we're all agree. What a great place to be. I am sharing with you a series of sermons about the kind of people that God desires for us to be. And our last section, we looked at the importance of being a reconciled people. And today we're looking at the importance of being a committed people. Would you bind your hearts together with me in prayer? Father, we pause to thank you for what we have already experienced with you and one another during this time of worship and fellowship together. And realizing the importance of what we're about to study from your word today, I offer myself as a vessel of freshening you into your hands at this very moment. Please cleanse me with the washing of the blood of your dear Son. Please anoint with the power of your sweet Holy Spirit, so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight, so that your purpose, your design purpose, might be accomplished for each of us as individuals, as families, and as a church collective. Because it's where I pray and praise it for victories I give in Christ's name. Amen. The scriptures are going to be projected behind me, but if you'd like to follow along in your Bible, I'd invite you to turn with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. In the book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3, Jesus is sharing seven messages to seven local churches. Seven local churches that represented the seven church ages that would exist from the resurrection of Christ until the second coming of Christ. And as we read the graphic description given by Christ of our church age in Revelation chapter 3, verse 15, it's very apparent that in the estimation of Christ, we are lacking a real commitment mentality. Revelation 3:15, Jesus said to that local church, and he's saying to we as a church age, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold or hot, I would thou wert cold or hot. To be sure, there are men within the body of Christ who are committed to various issues. There are some who are committed to addressing social injustices. There are some who are committed to relieving poverty, you name it. And in all probability, you will discover some individual or some group that is committed to that particular area of interest. And it's important that standing firm on such issues as addressing social injustices and relieving poverty may be, somehow, some way, you and I, as a closing generation before Christ returns, must recapture both the spirit and the strength of Psalm 37 and verse number 5. David was inspired by God's sweet spirit to pen to his generation, and God's sweet spirit is saying to our generation the very same thing. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. There are things that God wants to bring to pass in your life, and there are things that God wants to bring to pass in my life. But God will not bring certain things to pass until we meet the condition of committing our way to the Lord and trusting also in him. You see, our Heavenly Father yearns for us, as this verse has been translated, to roll our way from the Lord. Now, why is it important? Why is it important for you, and why is it important for me? Why is it important for us to roll our way from the Lord? is important because the Bible is very plain to instruct that there is a way that may seem right unto us, but the end thereof what? The end thereof is a place of death. Now, just in case no one has informed you or reminded you lately, your way and my way may not always be God's way. Sometimes we have a tendency of doing things the way we want to do it, how we want to do it, when we want to do it. Question: who is our ultimate example? Jesus, right? And the Bible affords us many beautiful and provoking glimpses of both the deity and the humanity of Christ. And I want to share one with you that you may never have thought about in regard to the commitment of God's Son. It's found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 3, Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Wherefore, holy brethren, holy sisters, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession in Christ Jesus. And he says, someone is about to ask, well, why is it important, why is it imperative that we consider him? Look at verse number 2. Who, speaking of Christ Jesus, who was faithful or committed, if you will, to him, talking about Heavenly Father, that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Jesus is to be your example, and Jesus is to be my example. Now, I don't know about you, but I believe that we as Christians have not only been called to bear the name of Christ, that's why we're called Christians, but we have also been called to reflect the likeness of our elder brother. And so the question I need to ask myself, and the question you need to ask yourself is this: is our calling any less than his? If we are Christians, and Christian means to be Christ-like, right? If we are Christians, if we're going to be like Jesus, is our calling any less than his? Let's look at verse 1 again of Hebrews 3, and then drop down to verse 14. Wherefore, holy brethren, holy sisters, partakers of the heavenly calling. Now, let me stop there a moment. Do you understand, my friends, that our calling is a heavenly calling? Amen. Our calling is not an earthly calling. Pastor Dan, what are you saying? God has not called us to look like the world. God hasn't called us to talk like the world. God hasn't called us to act like the world. God hasn't called us to eat and drink like the world. God has called you and God has called me to be different. Amen. God's called us to be peculiar people, zealous of good works. Amen. God has called us with a heavenly calling. Drop down to verse 14. For we are made partakers of Christ. Now, that's exciting to me. That's so exciting about my Pentecostal church. You know what I know about now, don't you?
Hallelujah.
That's right. Some of you said it already. I think I will say it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The moment you and I accepted Jesus as our personal Savior, the moment we placed our faith in the atoning blood of Jesus Christ, at that very moment we became a partaker with Jesus Christ. We became a partaker of Christ, and that is something to be excited about. But there is a condition. Continue reading. So we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence when? How long? Steadfast unto the end. Now listen to me carefully. Wonderful that you may have become a Christian 40 years ago. Marvelous we may become a Christian 4 years ago. Splendid that we may become a Christian 4 days ago. But my brothers and sisters, when Jesus returns in the clouds of glory, Christ is returning for a people who has an up-to-date relationship at that very moment.
Amen.
Because my Bible says it's not to the one that starts out in the way, but it's the one that endures unto the end, the same shall be saved.
Amen.
I want to be saved, don't you?
Amen.
I do not want to be lost. And so the Bible is plain to encourage that we as members of God's church are to be a committed entity. And I must confess to you that sometimes I ask myself this question. Dan, why is it sometimes you're up and sometimes you're down? Why is it that some of my Christian brethren sometimes seem to be up and sometimes they are down? Why is it we get on this roller coaster, if you will, of life and living? To be very specific, what was there about that local church of Laodicea? And what is there about our church age of Laodicea that Christ has characterized us, prompted him to characterize us as being lukewarm? Why? May I offer a suggestion? There are a number of answers to that question. But I believe with all my mind and all my heart, I'm convicted in my intellect and I'm convinced in my notions that one of the major reasons why we are lukewarm as a church age is because we have become overoccupied with the things of this world. Let's go back to Revelation chapter 3. Beginning again in verse 15. Jesus is saying to you, as he's saying to me, I know thy works, that thou art not a cold or hot, I know that thou wert cold or hot. Verse 16. So then because thou art lukewarm and not a cold or hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. And as if someone is about to ask, but Jesus, what is there about us that is bringing me to the very threshold of spitting us out of your mouth? Listen to the response in verse 17. Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increase with goods, and have need of nothing, not even you, God. Isn't that what your Bible says? That's exactly what my King James Version of the Bible says. I love you. Am I smiling? Can you see my teeth? I love you. But my brothers and sisters, there are too many of us that are treating God like a spare tire. As long as we're traveling down the highway of life and things are going smoothly, we have very little need of God. But as soon as we have a spiritual blowout or things happen in our lives, what do? We get on the telephone. We send out emails, we get on Facebook, and we ask people to pray for us. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, and thank God for those areas of communication that we can ask people to intercede for us. Amen?
Amen?
But my brothers and sisters, God takes no delight in being treated as a spare tire. God wants to be vibrant in your life, and God wants to be vibrant in my life every second of every minute, of every hour, of every day that we are living.
Amen.
And Jesus said to that local church, and he said to us, you're on the verge of being spit out of my mouth because you're saying, I'm rich, increase with goods, and have need of nothing. And you don't understand. You don't know that you're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor, blind, and naked. Now, will you agree with me that that is a very sad scene? But there's hope. There is a message of hope. Look at verse number 18. I counsel thee to buy me gold tried in fire. And as if someone is about to shout, well, Jesus, why do we need to go through this process? Jesus reverberates, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in fire that thou mayest be rich.
Amen.
Now, in your minds and in your hearts, if not in your Bible, I want you to draw a circle around that thou mayest be rich. And a line back up to verse number 17. Because we are bragging and we are boasting that we're rich. We increase with goods and have need of nothing. And Jesus says, no, you're not. And in the very next verse, Jesus says his desire for you and his desire for me is that we might be rich. You see, our estimation of riches is not always God's estimation of riches. I am a rich man. Not in the things of this world, but I am rich in so many other ways. And one of the ways in which I am rich is in respect to my wife. I am so thankful every day of my life that I did not marry that long-headed girl that could play the piano with one hand and the organ with the other hand. Because there's only one woman on the face of this earth that could have lived with me for almost 48 years now. She has dark hair and can neither play a note on the piano or the organ. I am a rich man. I have two daughters that love me. I have four grandchildren. I'm rich. And Jesus is wanting you and Jesus is wanting to me to understand that he has wealth that we have not even tapped into yet. That thou mayest be rich. In the book of Deuteronomy, there is a classic warning that Pastor Moses gave to physical Israel about not allowing the things of this world to captivate the mind and the heart. Go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 5, those of you that are following in your Bible. I want you to turn in and paint the scenario for you. The children of Israel have left the land of Egypt. They're standing on the threshold of entering into the land of Canaan. And in Deuteronomy chapter 5, Moses was inspired by God's sweet spirit to repeat the Ten Commandments. When he finished, drop down to verse number 33 of Deuteronomy 5. You shall walk in how many ways? One more time, how many ways? One more time, how many ways? You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God hath commanded you. Now, back up to verse number 32. You shall observe to do therefore as the Lord your God hath commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. My brothers and sisters, there are voices out there. There are shining lights out there that are trying to get your attention and my attention. And if we start looking to the things on the right or the things on the left and take our eyes off of Jesus, we will get in trouble. Now look again at verse 33. You shall walk, almost as if someone is about to ask, well, Pastor Moses, if we do this, what's in it for us? If we don't get distracted with things on the right and we don't get distracted with things on the left, if we walk in all the ways the Lord has commanded us, what are we going to get out of it? Look at it. You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God hath commanded you, that you may live. Is there anybody else here besides me that wants to live? Jesus said he came that we might have life and have life out.
More abundantly.
Life more abundantly. He continues. You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God hath commanded you, that it may be well with you. Anybody else here besides me want it to be well with you?
Amen.
He continues. You shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God hath commanded you, that you may prolong your days in the land which you shall possess. Is there anybody else here besides me that wants to prolong your days?
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, God is saying to spiritual Israel today the same message thousands of years ago. The message has not changed. If we will walk in all the ways of the Lord, God has ways of blessing us we have not even thought of yet. And then in chapter 6, Pastor Moses continued to call for commitment. And he sounded a clear note of warning against allowing an overoccupation with the themes of this world to dominate the lifestyle. Jump down to verse number 3, chapter 6. Hear therefore, Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with you, and that you may increase how? Mightily. You see, God not only wanted them to increase, God wanted them to increase mightily. God not only wants you and me to increase, God wants us to increase mightily. He continues, as the Lord God of thy fathers has promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Verse 4. Hear it, Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Verse 5. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with how much of your heart?
All
your heart. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with how much of your soul?
All
thy soul. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with how much of your might?
All
your might. Am I still smiling?
Amen.
Can you still see my teeth? I love you. But my brothers and sisters, it is time we stop playing church.
Amen.
And it's time we become the church.
Amen.
Are you listening to me? With God, it's all or it's nothing. Now, if you don't get upset, don't get upset with Pastor Dan. Get upset with Heavenly Father. Because Heavenly Father said to physical Israel then, and Heavenly Father said to spiritual Israel today, we must love Him with all of our heart, all of our soul, and all of our might. My dad died when I was very young, and my mother married again. And in our home, there were 5 of us boys. And my mother and my dad, I always called my stepdad my dad, because he was really the only dad I ever knew. And in our home, there was a sacred hour, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. That sacred hour was from 1 o'clock until 2 o'clock. We 5 boys were expected to be very quiet, no running around, no loud noises, because my mother and dad sat in their favorite easy chair and watched their favorite television program. It was called As the World. Wow, a couple of you have watched that too, haven't you? Just easy. But I can remember so vividly one of the commercials that played every day. It was an advertisement for a certain brand of soap. That's why they were called soap operas back then, because soap company sponsored them. And this particular brand of soap advertised it as being 99 and 44, 100% pure.
Ivory.
Any of you remember that soap?
Ivory.
You do, yeah, that's right. Now, would you agree with me that that's pretty pure? But with God, that's not good enough. God said, it's all or it's nothing. Because if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the sinner and the ungodly appear? Drop down to verse number 10. Because almost as if someone is about to ask, well, Pastor Moses, if we do this, again, what are we going to get out of it? Look at verse 10. And it shall be, when the Lord thy God shall have brought thee into the land which he sware to thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to give thee great and goodly cities, which thou buildest not. Never have to lay a brick. Verse 11. And houses full of all good things, which thou fillest not. Never have to go to a furniture store. And wells digged, which thou diggest not. They'll have to drill for oil. Vineyards and olive trees which thou plantest not. Now let us stop there and ask a question. Will you agree with me that that sounds like a pretty good deal? Somebody's going to give you a city. Going to give you a fully furnished house. A good water supply system. A good food supply system. Would you not agree with it? That's a pretty good deal. And what did God ask? Just one thing. Love me. Now, is that just an Old Testament principle? No. My Bible says in the New Testament, God will supply all my needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And what God promised then to physical Israel, God is still promising today to spiritual Israel. But there's not a period there. It continues. Rest of verse 11 and then verse 12. When thou shalt have eaten and be full, verse 12, then beware. And so someone is about to ask, but Pastor Moses, why do we need to beware? We have the cities, we have the houses, we have the water, we have the food. Why do we need to beware? Underscore for the rest of your life and living these words. Then beware, lest thou forget the Lord which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. You know what that sounds like? The church of Laodicea. We're rich. We're increased with goods. And we have need of nothing. Not even you, God. And God says, beware. In the Gospels, Jesus dealt with this principle on a number of occasions. But I just want to share one illustration with you from the book of Luke, chapter 18. A certain individual has come to Christ asking what he needed to do to inherit eternal life. And Jesus recounts to him certain commandments. And when Jesus finished rehearsing those commandments, I believe that individual looked at Jesus and smiled just as big as he could and said, Jesus, I have kept all of these for my youth up. Now, let's pick up the dialogue in Luke 18, beginning at verse number 22. When Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, yet lackest thou one thing. Sell all that thou hast, and distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Now let me stop there a moment. It's very important for us to understand in mind and in heart that Christ is not just asking that man to minister to those in poverty, as good as that is. You see, the real test of commitment is whether he would do that as he followed Jesus. Look at it. And come, follow me. Now, how did the man respond to that call for commitment? Look at verse 23. And when he heard this, he was very sorrowful, for he was very rich. Now, let me stop here and make an observation. Being wealthy is not a sin. Are you listening to me? Having money is not a sin. Having things is not a sin. The sin is when the things have us. Money is not a sin. But my Bible does say the love of money is what? The root of how much evil? The love of money is the root of all evil. So what's that say? An overoccupation with the things of this world is not good for us. And this man was overoccupied with material prosperity. Look at verses 24 and 25. And when Jesus saw that he was very sorrowful, he said, "How hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? For it is easier for a camel to go through a needle's eye than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God." He didn't say it's impossible, but he did say it's very difficult. And because of the mindset of those that were listening to that dialogue, they assumed a wrong conclusion. And so they asked the question in verse 26, "Jesus, who then can be saved?" And at that moment, Jesus seized the whole opportunity to inform that generation and our generation that victory over and over occupation with the material things of this world can only come through the supernatural power of God. In myself and in yourself, the tendency is to accumulate more and more and more. And isn't it amazing how fast it accumulates? Now, I am looking forward to being in your homes. My wife and I would love to visit, so we're looking forward to you inviting us to your homes. And when you invite me to your home, I promise you I will not do snooping. You know what snooping is? Is that a term you're familiar with here in this part of Florida? Well, those of you that may not know what snooping means, it means looking in places I should not be looking at times I should not be looking there. But if I were to do a little snooping, I probably would find a drawer, maybe a closet. Am I still smiling?